the mudaharat, before the demonstrations, a group of scholars, the Salafi background, I have great respect for them. Their fatwa unanimously, there was not one person of that background who had anything other than this. It is haram to participate in elections. Many of them said it is kufr. The standard fatwa, it is kufr to participate in these elections. Under the regime of Mubarak, that was their position. And even when the demonstrations began, many of them said, oh, we must obey the ruler, we cannot go out and protest. Many of them said this, and then many of them embraced. There was a beginnings of the split. And then slowly but surely, when the scholars realized, hold on a sec, if we just sit back and do nothing, then liberals, secularists, non-Muslims are going to come in and have their laws applied over us. And we're the majority of Egypt. We're Muslims and we're proud of it. Well, we better do something. So all of a sudden, in 1 week, from haram, it became wajib. And a very famous scholar, I'm not going to mention his name, said, to go and vote is a type of jihad of the boxes. And that caused him a lot of problems. Using the word jihad, everybody freaked out. He said it's a jihad of the boxes. I meant signing your name. Doesn't matter. That word jihad got him into trouble. My point being, subhanAllah, from haram and kufr and shirk, right? Within 1 week, two, you have to go and vote. And these are scholars. Many of you look up to them and respect them, and so do I. But I humanize them as well. I humanize them as well. I understand these scholars are not walking prophets or walking gods on earth. They're human beings. And they could be wrong. And they were wrong 5 years ago. And I used to say this back then as well. And alhamdulillah, we're getting to understand this point. The bottom line, brothers and sisters. Bottom line. One needs to be aware that the world is changing dramatically. You cannot stick to a text 700 years ago, neither can you open the door, floodgate, and change everything. Therefore, the scholars of Islam, not you, not the average person on the street, the real scholars of Islam, they need to act as seers. Take what we have to take, that we cannot change, and then change and adapt for what we need to. Because the bottom line is, there's no doubt that Iman is the most important thing, and that when you have it, it'll trump everything else. But sitting at home with ibadah and tahajjud is not going to change the world. The Prophet didn't just worship in Mecca and in Medina. He preached, he talked, he spoke, he fought, he did. That's what he did, right? He didn't just sit back and say, tawakkal ala Allah. When you do it, then you put your tawakkal. When you tie your camel, then you put your trust in Allah. Many of us don't even think of any camel to tie. And it's just a matter of let's be better Muslims, and that's good. Astaghfirullah, I'm not mocking that. But along with that, there has to be an understanding of what am I going to do besides just being a better Muslim? What am I going to do in the public arena, in my workplace, amongst my neighbors? What am I going to do to battle Fox News? What am I going to do to make sure these people around us don't demonize Islam? What am I going to do when these politicians are running for office, mock my religion and get away with it, and they're going to increase their votes because they're Islamophobic? Am I just going to sit back and do nothing? Or am I going to make sure that my voice is also heard? And in order for that to happen, one needs to think of the modern equivalents of the paper and the printing press. Right? In order for that to happen, one needs to be a little bit more open-minded, a little bit more willing for change. And one of the best things that happened post 9/11, all of us had to wake up. I myself, I have no problems admitting, pre 9/11, we're really not thinking along these lines. The wavelength of the brain is different. And post 9/11, all of a sudden, one realizes this is not. One needs to change and adapt to the times, or else you are not going to be living here. And therefore, bottom line, with the short illustration of printing presses and papers and whatnot, I wanted to show that once upon a time, the Ummah was at its strength, not just because of Islam and Iman, but also because they understood that they need to tie their camel and put their trust in Allah. But then a time came of overconfidence, of isolationism, of closing one's mind, of not thinking two steps ahead. And there are many examples for this, I just gave one example. And they refused to better themselves when it comes to the dunya, thinking that the deen and being Muslims was enough, but it wasn't enough. And we have suffered a terrible price with the loss of everything. What we are now in the situation we're in, it's all a result of the last 150 years. So inshallah ta'ala, now that we understand a little bit, like I said, the problem of a lecture is, I just give you a tantalizing teaser. Now that we understand a little bit, inshallah, the next goal upon me and all of you is knowledge and then action. Two simple things, knowledge and action. Once we have these two, inshallah, we can begin the conversation. I hope that inshallah this was of some benefit in Allah Ta'ala. And now we open the floor for questions and answers, inshallah. Maybe sit down or stand up. Stay here. Go.
We have a few minutes for questions and answers, about 5 minutes. There is a wireless mic right behind the camera. If you have a question, please ask, and Shaykh Yasir, inshallah, will try to answer.
Assalamu alaikum. Jazakumullah khair, Shaykh. What's kind of equivalent to the invention of papers is the computers with modern technology and with iPhone and iPad and so forth. What's your advice to our young generations, how they get the best out of these devices instead of downloading iTunes and all that stuff? How they can use it to further our knowledge, our inventions, to go back where we should be?
The brother correctly points out that in our times, the equivalent of the printing press is the internet, is modern technology, gadgetry. And the question is, what should our youth do in order to better their utilization of these materials in order to further the spread of Islam? I think the answer to that really is pretty obvious. It's from what we have already said. First thing they need to do is acquire knowledge and know what the religion is. You cannot help Islam if you don't know what Islam is. You cannot defend Islam when you don't know what to defend. So the first thing they need to do is to learn their religion. And then each one of them needs to get involved in their areas of specialities. Alhamdulillah, there are so many good apps on the iPhone and on the internet. There's so many good websites that we can use. This is something that, alhamdulillah, abdullahi wasi'. There's so many ways for people to do whatever they have a passion, whatever they have a strength for, whatever they have a motivation for. Because realize, without motivation, you're not going to get anywhere either. And Allah has blessed everyone with different motivations. So for some people, programming a specific type of app really makes them feel productive and useful. That's great. For others, making a website. For others, printing flyers. So the bottom line, you need to see what are my talents, what are my motivations and factors, what makes me click, what makes me motivated, right? My niche is very clear, that is knowledge and teaching knowledge. I'm not really into computer programming, I still don't know how to write an HTML. It's not my forte and I really don't want to learn. So many of you love this, you know, programming and whatnot, do what you can. You help me out, I help you out, that's the whole point, right? Every one of us has a particular niche. And as long as you master that particular niche, as long as you're good at it, alhamdulillah, us put together, we're going to make the entire structure. So as it is, there's a lot of good apps, by the way, on the iPhone. I'm sure there are others on the Androids and other. I'm not really, I have my iPhone, so I only know the iPhone apps. But there's a lot of good apps, but they could be better. I mean, there's a lot of apps that I have an idea for as well. Come to me, I can give you ideas for apps that I have. But inshallah, whatever you can do, there is no one answer for your question. Whatever you feel a passion for and you have the skills to do, that's what you need to do.
Other questions? Sister side? Any questions from this side?
As-salamu alaykum. When it comes to the different texts and where to get knowledgeable information, that seems to be kind of a difficulty, especially on the internet. What is a good way to differentiate between the different sources? Which ones are the best and which ones aren't? Especially if you're new to Islam or you're just starting to educate yourself towards Islam.
The question is about... everybody can hear. I might read the question. You have a microphone. It's a very good question. It's a very pertinent question. And the answer is not that simple. Firstly, realize for the advanced students, not for the new converts, for the advanced students, you will always benefit some knowledge from some person. Always. There will always be something of benefit. And the more your teachers are, the more broad-minded and the more skills you acquire, the more knowledge you acquire. No matter what the person's background, you will be able to get something from him or her that will benefit you. However, the question arises, what if I'm not an advanced student taking all these courses? What if I just want to, you know, study one thing or have one person? Well, then I would advise you to do one simple thing, and that is make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He blesses you and guides you to a teacher that is useful for you. Because the fact of the matter is that it is a confusing world out there. And especially for converts, when they think that Islam is one monolithic entity, and then they discover that it's actually a kaleidoscope, and they need to figure out one narrow prism for them to fit in, it's overwhelming. There's a good book that a friend of mine has written. It's called, Now That I've Accepted Islam, What Do I Do With It? And it's meant for new converts, and you find it online. Now That I've Accepted Islam, What Do I Do With It? By Dr. Abdullah Brown. And it's basically a beginner's guide to Islam, about all the differences in Islam and what to do. But the bottom line is there is no easy answer, and you're going to have to trust your instincts and pray to Allah to bless you with good instincts. That somebody's going to appeal to you, somebody's going to basically, yeah, this person, I just clicked, I completely understand where this person's coming from. They seem scholarly, they seem knowledgeable, they seem relevant. That's a decision you need to make. I can't just tell you, go to here, go to there. You need to make up your mind about, you know, which institute or which group of scholars you know, you're going to ask your questions to, and make dua to Allah. And realize that if Allah has guided you this far, He's not going to let go of you now. So put your trust in Allah. You've come this far. Alhamdulillah, the differences within Islam are much less trivial than when you're outside of it. Right? So alhamdulillah, now that you're in, put your trust in Allah, make dua, be open-minded, listen to different people, and take the good from everybody, inshallah.
I think we have probably one more question.
You explained through the lecture how, for example, the printing press, how Islamic scholars at first didn't like it, and how they rejected it. But then eventually, as the years went on, after centuries, then they accept it, and then they like it. They like this thing that came from the non-Muslim world. What about vice versa? Where we, the Muslims, develop something, or we have something in our deen, or from our studies, for example, in our belief we don't like interest. You know, it's an economic thing. So, like, say we want to help the non-Muslims with their economy, and we want to try to help the non-Muslims understand things, why interest is bad, or any other type of economic policy that we have, but it's not inherent in their world. How do we try to help them and try to explain them this invention or this thing, help them out, but they reject us? So what do we do?
MashaAllah, that's a really great question. You're thinking three steps ahead. Unfortunately, we haven't even taken the first step. You're thinking three steps ahead, and that's great. People need to think along those lines. I think personally, I feel we need to concentrate on preserving our own heritage for our fellow Muslims. Moving up ahead, subhanAllah, let me give you one example. These days, every second person on earth, basically, in the Western world, believes in the theory of evolution. These days, believing in a God is deemed to be backward. You know, the theory of evolution, Darwinism, is now standard. It is taught in science schools. Anybody who opposes it, anybody who says this is not true, is made to be an utter fool, an incompetent, literalist, fundamentalist who's not willing to open his mind to science, right? To this day, no Muslim has ever written a comprehensive critique of the theory of evolution that fulfills our spiritual and faith requirements and takes into account modern scientific facts. We haven't done that yet. It's not been done. I mean, personally, I know many of you are going to think of one particular author in Turkey. He has not done a scientific job at all. Ask anybody in the scientific community. These are not scientific books. They're popularist books. Nobody has taken on this theory from a Muslim. Christians have attempted to do it. They've attempted to, and they have a spectrum of responses. But you know, Christian fundamentalism is very different than Islamic literalism, right? I don't like using the term fundamentalism. And many Christians to this day do not believe that there were dinosaurs, as you know the famous Sarah Palin question. Many people do not believe that we've been around more than 6,000 years on Earth. Many people do not believe that there were Neanderthals and other human-like species. Whereas we as Muslims have no problems affirming all of these things. We have no problems affirming the existence of other creations of Allah. All that we will believe is that Homo sapiens, as we exist, are the descendants of Adam and Eve. This is something clear cut in the Quran that we cannot deny, right? So where is the scientist? Where is the biologist who has taken what we know of science, has taken the Quranic story, and then written a book that basically shows the world we have a religion that makes logical sense. We have a religion that is not backward. We still haven't even done this. And in my opinion, it's one of the most important scientific books that needs to be written from an Islamic perspective, right? So you're talking about interest, you're